I was preparing a sermon topic on marriage based on a viewer request, and I had the television on in the background. And as I listened to the commentary, it just so happened that the subject matter was on the Discovery Channel about aliens. And it convicted me to look into the subject matter of freedom for this particular sermon lesson, and I will get to my original topic on marriage before the end of the month. Freedom is today's sermon lesson subject for many reasons, one of which is we are celebrating the 4th of July here in the United States, and many of us have been taught in schools that, we were persecuted in England, our forefathers came over and to escape high taxes, etc. And there's certainly elements of truth there, but I want to take a look a little deeper at freedom today. And I also want to comment before I get into this that there is a huge media agenda to educate people, and the idea that the aliens are coming and we've got all these UFO sightings, and should the government release content to the public, yes or no? This has been going on since after World War II. It's nothing new. And as shown in another video on this channel, there was a huge explosion of using the word alien in modern Bibles, especially after Vatican II concluded in the early to mid 1960s. So we've been indoctrinated with things that we have to take back to Scripture. That's my whole point. You have to take everything back to God's Word and prove it. Is it Lucifer and the fallen angels, or are they aliens from another world? Well, God never talks about aliens outside the firmament coming in and attacking us. So that's why we need to understand that God's word is true and we are made free. And I hope that you find this topic on freedom inspiring, because I would like for people to spend a little time this weekend, or any time for that matter, and study their Bibles and look into the subject matter a little deeper that I'm going to be covering today, because it's easy to take for granted. Please look at the screen or turn in your Bibles to John chapter 8, verse 32. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. What is truth? Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. He is our rock, and his word is how we righteously judge everything. So when we're taught to believe things, we need to take it back in prayer to God's word. And there we will find truth. So the purpose today is I'm going to talk about what is freedom, and then freedom fighters. I'm going to go through briefly some important people in history that without them we may not be enjoying the freedom that we have today. And then I'm going to talk about why do we need to escape the propaganda and the media. And then I'm just going to conclude briefly by celebrating freedom that we have. But this is going to be done not only on a secular level, but mostly a Christian level. And I really hope that people will be inspired just to take a fresh look at things and to think about events that have happened in the past that maybe we haven't considered enough this time of year. So what is the key to freedom, first of all? In Psalm 119 it says, "Thy word is true from the beginning, and every one of thy righteous judgments endureth forever." Jesus Christ is the key to our freedom as Christians. Why do we need freedom? Because we're in captivity, we're born unto trouble. And as I say here, people are already judged and on their way to hell by default. I mean, you're not born saved, you're born condemned already. Lost people are confounded. That's why we have so many different Bibles, is that no one can figure out what the Holy Spirit is saying to people. So instead of putting faith in God and getting born again of the Spirit so that you can understand the Word, we make greater and greater abominations. All these false Bibles in the markets are dumbed down so that men can understand what they think their God is telling them. Lost people do not hear God's incorruptible voice. I mean, to have an incorruptible, inerrant testimony is an abomination in the land of scholarship. Once you have something that people can trust and put faith in, then there's no more reasons to have the scholars around. And that's the whole game out there, and I've been right in the midst of it. And as I've mentioned before, if you want to find the most evil people on earth, look to commercial Christianity. That's where you'll find them. No one gets saved without permission from God the Father, so the idea that somebody's going to pray a prayer and they're welcomed into the kingdom of heaven, well, God's going to receive a person. Not only does a person need to receive God, God needs to try their faith and receive them in order for somebody to get saved. And no man's going to come to Jesus Christ except God the Father gives permission, because being a Christian is a very special thing. Few get saved. And I talk about this often, is that salvation is for few, not many. Few. And that's few within the professing Christian community. And why is that? Because few believe in an incorruptible testimony, and few have true faith. The devil deceives the whole world, and he uses his false church Babylon to corrupt all of man's religions and false Bibles. So I gave some scriptural references there, but these are subjects that are defined in a multitude of places in God's Word. So we need freedom, through Jesus Christ. And I just want to take a look back real briefly. And, you know, instead of talking about Thomas Jefferson and George Washington and a lot of the traditional, we'll call them founding fathers and key heroes of the revolution and the independence movement for the United States of America, I'm going to talk about who did what for the Word of God that we have access to today. We're going to bring out a number of Catholic priests here to start with. John Wycliffe, who was a Catholic priest. Basically, you can read what's on the screen. I went over to Europe and talked to a number of curators and have done a lot of research over the last, especially 15 years. And John Wycliffe, really his contribution of getting the Latin Bible of the Catholic Church into the English language that the common people could understand, started to create an awareness in the Catholic Church, in the people of the Catholic Church, of what God's Word says, and started to create divisions. And all because of Wycliffe getting the Jerome's Latin into English. And Jerome's Latin, although it was corrupt, not as much of an abomination as what we have today, based on my personal study. And so he was rewarded by being persecuted. And as you can read there, they hated him so much, the Catholic Church did, that they dug up his bones and burned them. And they declared him a heretic. You can research more about John Wycliffe independently. But, you know, God uses people, even Catholic priests, to come out from her, my people, come out from Babylon. And once a person with true faith gets knowledge of the Word of God and they put belief and trust in Jesus Christ, this is what happens. A guy named John Huss, or Jan Hus, he was convicted by a lot that John Wycliffe did. He was another priest, Catholic priest, and he was persecuted greatly. And he was quoted as saying, when they persecuted him and martyred him, "In 100 years, God will raise up a man whose calls for reform cannot be suppressed." And almost exactly 100 years later, Martin Luther nailed his 95 Theses of Contention onto the church door in Wittenberg, Germany. And I believe this is God's way of using people to communicate to us what he's doing with the Catholic Church and how he's causing reformation through his word. A guy named Erasmus, Desiderius Erasmus, was a brilliant Catholic priest, and he also mentored a guy named William Tyndale, but he was great at Latin, and he came up with a Latin-Greek New Testament, and that proved to be instrumental in laying the foundation of William Tyndale's work, leading all the way up to the authorized version of 1611. This man was brilliant, and he is not fondly remembered by the Roman Catholic Church either, but you can research this independently. I went over to Belgium and went to Erasmus House in Belgium and talked to curators, and I did my own research extensively when I was in Europe, and so I've looked into this. I don't surf the internet only. I go over and I've actually looked into the historical truths surrounding Erasmus, and I'm very thankful to God for using this man. Martin Luther was another Catholic priest, and as I mentioned before, he nailed a copy of his 95 Theses to the door of a church in Wittenberg, Germany, and he was basically rebelling against the corruption of the papacy and the corrupt teachings of the Catholic Church because he had knowledge of the Word of God, and his language was German primarily. And as a young Catholic, I myself was taught that he was the main person responsible for breaking up the true church, because Catholics don't believe non-Catholics are saved people. They believe they're the only ones who are in the true church. I was also taught that the King James Bible was corrupt, and as a Catholic, I never heard anything about the pure Word of God. That's my own testimony. But I can tell you, they hate Luther and they hate King James. Those are the two people I heard about as a very young person. And, you know, I didn't have hardly any biblical knowledge at all until I became an adult. And God led me on my own, on a path that he had prepared for me to discover his word. So Martin Luther, very important. Please research this independently. William Tyndale, another Catholic priest, that was burned at the stake. He's quoted as saying, "Lord, open the eyes of the King of England," or "open the King of England's eyes." And he did the New Testament based on his training under Desiderius Erasmus. William Tyndale was able to complete the New Testament in Greek, and from that they used the New Testament and they completed an Old Testament translation, and people in England in the middle 1530s were able to get a complete canon of scripture. This guy was held in captivity over 500 days. When I was in Vilvoord, Belgium, I went down into, they did a replica of the chambers that he was held captive in, and I went down there, and this poor guy suffered in a small, probably 8 foot by 10 foot brick, kind of like a cell underground. It was very dank, very dirty. I'm sure there were rats and roaches everywhere, and he suffered greatly, and they burned him at the stake for what he did in terms of translating God's word, ultimately from Greek into English. And so he studied, he learned Greek under Erasmus, and then he put the New Testament into the English language, and then by the middle 1530s, the people in England had an entire canon of scripture in the English language. Thomas Cranmer, who was an Archbishop of Canterbury of England, unlike the other guys who were Catholic priests, he was killed by Bloody Mary, who happened to be a Catholic monarch, and she killed him. And it's quoted here that he refused the Pope. He proclaimed the Pope to be Antichrist, filled with false doctrine. And as the flames drew around him as he was burned, he was said to say that unworthy hand, and his dying words were, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." So this just goes to show the price that was paid for people putting their trust in the Word of God. Research Thomas Cranmer. His name is associated with an English Bible. And you'll find where there is truth, there is heavy persecution. And these men paid with their lives, or they were persecuted relentlessly and hated while they were on earth. So I think it's important for us to remember as Christians some of these people, as well as our traditional founding fathers, this time of year as we celebrate the 4th of July. In Romans chapter 8, verse 10, it says, "And if Christ in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the spirit is life because of righteousness." And in Romans chapter 6, it says, "For he that is dead is freed from sin." When you get born again, the Holy Spirit comes in you because you are a true believer with true faith. And God doesn't count your flesh against you because you're born of the Spirit. You now have a spiritual body in addition to your natural body. And you're justified by grace through faith, because you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and His word is true, and He will then teach you and lead you to all truth by the power of the Holy Spirit, and you will use God's word as a standard and measure everything that you're taught back to God's word. And that's what being a Christian is. I'm going to close by just commenting. Before 1630, King James died in 1625, England was gifted the Alexandrinus manuscript, and in my opinion, the ultimate person behind the curtain was the Pope, but that's not what the history books will teach you. The history books, I believe, will say it came from Russia or someplace like that. But this is important in history because by the time King James dies, there's a huge reformation going on in England, and people are coming out from the Catholic Church, and the Church of England is gaining prominence, and people are wanting independence from the papacy. They don't want anything to do with the papacy. So what happened is they had an Archbishop of Canterbury named Archbishop Laud, and he was very friendly with the papacy. And that wound up causing a lot of problems in England, especially after King James died. They get an Egyptian manuscript called the Alexandrinus, which is a Septuagint manuscript, which is looked favorably upon by the Roman Catholic Church, and is a Greek manuscript that potentially could wind up rendering the Roman Catholic Latin either obsolete or secondary in importance. And so there is a tactic here going on to get England back under the power of the papacy, in my opinion. And so a lot of people were being persecuted, and it's time to get out of England because of the Roman persecution. So, you know, we're all taught in school that, you know, the English monarchy was corrupt, and you know, we had to escape high taxes, and you know, the bad monarchy in England and all this and that. But what's really the root cause? I go back to the Word of God. There's two types of people in this world, Christians and heathens, and there's two different churches. Let's just say God's true church and Babylon, okay? And what we want to do is understand true history. So, was this a new strategy for a Greek Bible, not Latin? And did the reformers and people that were persecuted, did they flee and come to North America to escape not only the English monarchy, which was being corrupted, but the papacy, the Church of Rome? Was that the main root cause for the escape? Well, who writes the history books? And what is truth? I think it's something for everyone to pray about and think about, but I'm throwing that out as we celebrate again the 4th of July and all of our freedoms that we enjoy today. Let's take a look back at real history as it's measured against God's word. So beginning in 1630, shortly after this Alexandrinus is presented to England, as many as 20,000 Puritans emigrated to America to gain liberty to worship God as they chose, based on either the Geneva Bible or the 1611 Bible, primarily, most settled in New England. But as soon as they're escaping, does the papacy come over to the U.S. to greet them? Is there a coincidence that the state of Maryland is Maryland, and there's a state called Virginia? Do those have any Roman Catholic influence? And, you know, how long did it take for the Church of Rome to set up shop in the United States? Something to think about. So I'm going to conclude by just saying saved Christians can confess our freedoms. We're made free by the truth of Jesus Christ. And if you're a saved Christian and you feed on God's word, you can discern and judge righteous judgment by the word of God. You don't judge by appearance. You don't believe the television. You don't believe the history books. You don't believe anything without measuring it against the word of God. Because whatever measurement we meet will be measured back against us again. And Jesus warns about that. He's like, if you start judging things by your own ideas and your own unrighteous judgments, based on appearance or what you think you can intellectualize, that's going to be a problem at the time of the Christian judgment. So we want to bring everything back to God's word, because we've been made free by the Lord Jesus Christ.